In 2010, the Singing Men of Texas embarked on a God-sized task to take the life-saving gospel of Jesus Christ to the people of Ukraine. What began as a single trip has turned into an epic series of mission journeys that God has used to draw nearly 15,000 people to Himself. 2012 was the most ambitious year yet for the Singing Men, with two trips to Ukraine scheduled in April and September. What God did in the hearts of thousands of people during these 23 days of missions can only be described as supernatural. As we had in previous years, we partnered with evangelist Michael Gott, who for decades has been used of God to do an incredible work in Ukraine. With an anointed gift of evangelism, as well as a team of Ukrainian nationals already on the ground, and relationships with local churches already well established, Michael Gott was just the man God had for this incredible job. The April trip kicked off with a packed house at First Baptist Church Odessa, and in that first concert we saw over 1,000 in attendance and 547 decisions for Christ. The next day in Nikolaev, at one of the city's largest concert halls, 1,700 people packed into a 1,500-seat auditorium, and there were 757 decisions for Christ that night. And it only got better from there. Over the course of 2 weeks, we sang to nearly 9,000 people and saw 3,998 decisions registered for Christ. But God was not through with us in Ukraine. In September, the men returned for another round of evangelistic concerts, and again, night after night, people packed the venues and came to Christ. In one city, we returned to a church that was destroyed by fire just days before we were to sing there in 2010. Now, with the help of over $70,000 raised by the Singing Men, Michael Gott, and our mission partners, the church has been rebuilt and it was bursting at the seams when we returned to present two concerts to a combined audience of nearly 2,000 people, 667 of whom made decisions for Christ. In Zaporozhye, a 5,000-seat sports arena built for the purpose of advancing the communist agenda reverberated with the message of the gospel. And in that one concert, over 1,100 responded to Christ. Between the April and September trips, God used the Singing Men of Texas to draw over 8,300 people to Himself. The Lord has given the Singing Men an incredibly unique platform for presenting the gospel to the people of Ukraine. And with millions still out there who need to hear the message of the cross, the combined forces of all six chapters of the Singing Men of Texas will return to Ukraine once again in the spring of 2015, this time specifically targeting the largest arenas across the nation. As many as 20,000 people will hear the gospel, and if the Lord blesses as He has in previous trips, we could expect to see over 40% of those make decisions for Christ. May Christians everywhere who hear this testimony have awakened within them a fire to reach the world for Christ. If the Great Commission is the great omission of your life, then it is time to step outside the walls of the church and reach out across the street and around the world. When God leads, He provides. All we must do is obey and say, "Here I am, Lord, send me."
Oh, my God. singing men of North Central Texas, made up of men from churches in the greater Dallas-Fort Worth area, partnered with Michael God in the initial project to take the gospel to the people of Ukraine. And the results of that mission sounded like first-hand reports of the work God did on the day of Pentecost. Amen?
Amen.
Where there were 3,000 souls saved. In that April trip, there were over 3,000 that came to Christ during that trip. Wow. Amen? The success, after the success of that 2010 Ukraine mission effort, planning began on the 2012 project. And the initial plan was to invite all of the Singing Men chapters, all six chapters, to go back, partner with Michael God again, and to see what God would do. They would again, the plan that they used initially in all of 2012 was to go down the Dnieper River in a riverboat, and at night the boat would move to the next port while everybody slept, except the captain. And then they would get out at the next port city during the day, go out and invite people in and do the concert. Then that night they would sleep again and go to the next port. It sounded like a pretty neat deal and worked out really, really well. And that was the initial plan, doing concerts in port cities from Kiev down to Kherson, where the river flows into the Black Sea. And after hearing the reports of what happened in 2010, I wanted to get in on the 2012 project. Wouldn't you?
Amen.
Amen. But God held me back. Each time I prayed about signing up to be a part of the 2012 Ukraine Mission Project, I felt in my spirit that God was telling me no. That just didn't seem right. Long ago, I learned that God answers prayers in three ways. Sometimes He says yes. Sometimes He says no. And sometimes He says wait. And we all know that wait is a four-letter word. But I felt like God wasn't even telling me wait. He was telling me no. And I did not understand, but I did not go. The group left for Ukraine without me on September 24, 2012, exactly 2 weeks after I was released from the hospital after complications from gallbladder surgery. Oh, now I see. God had told me no because He was aware that I would not be able to keep up with the physical requirements of such a ministry event. God is in control. God knows the end from the beginning. And in my case, when He told me no, later it became not this time, which then became wait. So beginning in 2013, each month at our Singing Men concerts, I watched the video you just saw. And I began again to be praying about the privilege of participating this time in this Pentecostal-sized project. This time, God said yes, and I updated my passport and began preparing to go. And when I studied experiencing God several years ago, I learned that we should find where God is working and join Him there. Certainly, God was working in Ukraine, and at last, I was going to have the opportunity to join Him there. What took place in Ukraine last month was a God-sized response to the cries for help and the yearning for hope on the part of the people of Ukraine. God sent His message of hope in a strong, coordinated, multi-pronged blast of love. Let me explain what I mean. God's message of hope came through the work of prayer. The churches in most hosts, in each host city had spent months praying for the events before we arrived. During each concert, there were teams of Ukrainians and Americans praying for God's power to fall right then. Even now, the churches who received the response cards from those who made decisions are praying with and praying for the individuals who responded in each city. The local churches are following up on all the decisions made while we were there. God's message of hope also came through the work of ministry volunteers. 70 plus Americans and countless Ukrainian church members worked side by side to hand out programs and ballpoint pens before the concerts and hand out Bibles after the concerts. They teamed together to serve as greeters, interpreters, and hosts and hostesses at each venue. God's message of hope came through the playing of instrumental music. As you heard during the prelude, or the music while you were eating, the schools and churches in Ukraine place a great emphasis on music played on brass, woodwind, string, and percussion instruments. Our instrumental ensemble that we had with our group played a mini concert before each of the main concerts. These musicians were primarily from the North Central chapter of Singing Men, but the drummer was from our South Texas chapter. His name is Chris Regis. He's the minister of music at Second Baptist in Corpus. He was my roommate on the trip, and you're going to see him prominently in a video yet to come. Also, God's ministry of, or his message of hope came through the voice of a very much beloved Ukrainian music evangelist. Valeria Shcherbina spoke and sang as one Ukrainian to another. He brought words and songs of hope in their own language. There was such a spiritual connection, and his powerful singing was accompanied by his very talented son, Vitaly. God's message of hope also came through the artistry of painting. Lance Brown, a colorblind Christian speed painter and speaker, shared Jesus in a unique way using his God-given abilities to, as he says, spread the gospel with paint. This surprising work of art was presented at each concert to the delight of the audience. I want you to watch this video. I always was on the back side of this canvas, okay? I was so glad to get home and finally see what he did. But anyway, I want you to watch this. This song is called Ukrainian Alleluia. The words are very difficult. Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. The notes are not so easy. But the people of Ukraine know this song. Thank you. Lance is writing the word hope in Ukrainian. The two colors that are in their flag are blue and gold. Sing a little bit of Russian as a way to bridge the cultural and national gap. And the night we sang in Ivano-Frankivsk, there was a small team of locals who came to the concert with their video cameras. Not real sure who invited them or tipped them off or what, but they came and some of them were all over the platform the whole concert. There was, we had kind of dodged them. They shot video all during the concert and stayed up all night to edit this song and the next one you get ready to see, and synchronize the video. The next morning, we found this video posted on YouTube. In this video clip, you will see the greeting that the people did, the crowds, the singing that took place, the painting, the preaching, and all the while we sang the song that you and I opened with this evening. Mighty to Save. Mighty to Save is a song that the Ukrainian church sings, and it is the song on which we attempted to sing Russian in some of the places. Probably about half of the places we sang the Russian and half of the places we didn't, because it would have been offensive in some places. We had to check that each time. This video will give you a good idea of the joy and excitement and the God-sized work that God was doing every night. Let's run this one. This is the last video. They really liked that one. We really had a blast on that one. There was another song we sang. I just wanted to read you some of the text because to me this was perhaps the most significant song in terms of what it says as to describe what we were trying to do. It's a prayer, and the song is called Your God Will Come. This is a message we needed to take to the Ukrainian people. Strengthen the feeble hands and steady the knees that give way. Say to those with fearful hearts, be strong and not afraid, for your God will come. Your God will come with a vengeance, with divine holy fire. Your God will come to save you. O God of Abraham, in the midst of the darkness, shine. Make the desert to live again. Shower peace on these troubled times. For your God will come. Your God will come with a vengeance, with divine holy fire. Your God will come to save you. And that, to me, kind of was the theme of what we were up to, what we were trying to do. The message of God's hope came through some more ways. It came through the preached word. About halfway through each concert, the singing men would leave the stage and take a break, during which international evangelist Michael Gott would preach to the crowd through an interpreter. I first met Michael during the 1980s when he preached a revival in our church in Tulsa. And he is still doing revivals stateside also and in other countries. He is a wise and effective evangelist who is loved by the Ukrainian churches and their leaders. Michael, who is now in his 70s, is enthusiastic, creative, powerful, and driven to reach people with the gospel of Christ. He preached a devotional to us nearly every morning, emceed and preached at every concert, and issued the invitation by having the people fill out the card that they received in the program. And this is how they registered their decision. And God's message of hope came through the written word of God. Everyone who turned in a response card, whether it had anything on it or not, if they turned in the card, they received a free CD of the singing men and a free Ukrainian Bible. Everyone who attended the concert received a ballpoint pen that had printed on it a website address where they could get more information about Christ. The message of hope came through the act of the personal touch. At the close of each final concert each evening, and I say it that way because sometimes we did one, two concerts, sometimes two, but at the end of whatever the last one was, Michael would tell the people that the singing men love Ukraine, and that they love the Ukrainian people, and that they would love to meet you after the concert. Then he would say, and you may be asking, do the singing men of Texas speak Ukrainian? Then he would answer, no, but they smile in Ukrainian. And they love that. And we would be able to greet the people outside, and the Lord was gracious in weather. We weren't rained on, I don't believe, any night that we did a concert. And so we were able to greet the people for sometimes about 30 minutes before we had to load the bus and head on home. Some of the Ukrainian people speak some English, so communication was possible. And a whole lot of pictures were taken, especially with the guys who brought their cowboy hats. Ours was a group of about 180 Americans and about 15 Ukrainians traveling across sometimes very bumpy roads in four buses. I was asked to serve as bus captain for Bus A. My primary responsibilities were to make sure we didn't leave anybody behind and also to pass along announcements about the venue we were approaching or the schedule for the next day. We presented 12 concerts in 8 public venues over the course of 8 days. In 4 of the venues, we did back-to-back concerts, one at 5 o'clock and then another one at 7 o'clock. And on Sunday, we divided the group in half, sending our two buses to one church and two buses to another for morning worship. We stayed in 3 nice hotels during our 10 nights in Ukraine. That's the, one of the church groups. That's a view outside my window the first night. Isn't that beautiful? It's a temple across the street. We were told not to drink the water unless it had been boiled. They even warned us about not opening our mouth in the shower because we could get sick. So we drank lots and lots of bottled water to keep our voices hydrated. I don't think I've ever drunk as much water as I did that those 2 weeks, but that's a good idea. Ukrainian meals, I've been asked about the food. They often included soup, so this is very appropriate tonight. Lots of potatoes, I love those. Cucumbers and tomatoes and bread and other vegetables. Not the bread's a vegetable, but cucumbers, tomatoes, and other vegetables. Their primary meat is pork, but we saw some chicken, and there was one time that they had steak. I got chicken not realizing that was steak. So anyway, but the food was good. Breakfast was usually in the hotels. And when I went down to breakfast on the first morning after we had gotten back to Kiev toward the end of the trip, I knew we were getting closer to Texas when I found crisp brown bacon on the buffet. We usually had eggs, but I was unable to locate any contact. There was an amazing amount of preparation done by the Michael Gott International Organization and a massive amount of preparation by all of the host churches who fed us in their facility or prepared sack meals for us to eat between concerts and on the bus. Because we stayed in 3 hotels but sang in 8 cities, we traveled by bus each day to the concert city and then back to the hotel. Sometimes the ride home was 2.5 to 3 hours. One night we arrived back at the hotel at 12:30 in the morning and had to be back on the buses at 5 o'clock in the morning to leave for the train station. Some people think going on choir tour is glamorous. This kind of schedule will convince you otherwise. That night when Chris came into the room, I told him, "Welcome to the day with no night." And he said he might write a song using that line as a title. By the way, I did take a nap on the train. The halls in which we sang were magnificent, certainly among the finest concert halls I've ever sung in. And even though it was a brief part of only one of the songs, I got to sing a solo in every one of these magnificent rooms. What a joy. Hey. Oh, it just not coming up. Enjoy this, yeah. When I got home and saw some of these, I had to change my Facebook picture. I mean, hey, why not?
Oh, I like that.
Yeah.
That's good. That was so fun. I did take one selfie, but it hadn't made it to anything public, so. Let me tell you about the places where we sang. In Zitomer, we sang in the Kurji Theater, which has 1,100 seats. In 2 concerts, our attendance was 1,750, with 1,037 decisions.
Wow.
In Berdichev, we sang in the Palace of Culture. 1,000 seats, 1 concert, 1,200 people packed in to the 1,000 seats with 516 decisions.
Wow.
In Rivne, we sang in the Academic Concert Hall, which has 700 seats. In 2 concerts, 1,300 people attended with 731 decisions. In Lviv, we sang in the beautiful Academic Theater of Opera, which has 1,000 seats. In 1,000 seats, okay, you ready? In 2 concerts, there were 2,100 attending with 1,042 people making decisions. In Lutsk, we were in the Lutsk Theater Hall, which has 775 seats. 1,500 people crowded into that one concert. Did you get that? 775 seats, 1,500 people registering 970 decisions. Now, in these pictures, you can see that the people filled the aisles down the middle and on the sides. They stood there for the full hour and a half concert. Then they filled the foyer. More people were coming. There were people standing beyond the foyer who didn't see any of the concert at all, but they could at least hear. The next morning, we were told that someone had called the local fire marshal in hopes of shutting down the event. Let me just parenthetically, Michael shared with us some of the response card comments. He said, not everybody is happy we're here. There were some saying, no, we don't want you to come back. Go back to Texas and don't ever come back. One comment was, go to this website and find out how stupid you are. One comment was, quit shoving these lies on these people. So not everybody was thrilled we were there. So somebody called the fire marshal in hopes of shutting us down. Sure enough, the Lutsk fire marshal came and saw what was taking place, but God was at work. As it turned out, John, one of our mission volunteers, was the fire marshal in his hometown back in Texas. Our fire marshal met the Lutsk fire marshal, showed him his badge from Texas, bribed him with a Singing Men CD, and the concert never stopped. Aren't you glad God is omniscient? And aren't you glad that this Texas fire marshal answered God's call to go to Lutsk that night? In Ivano-Frankivsk, we sang in the regional music theater that had 1,000 seats, and in two concerts, there were 2,000 who attended with 1,134 decisions. And don't advance yet, but this is the hall where the Mighty to Save video was made. And let me just say, I'm giving you all these numbers because those are some of the things we like to hear about. And frankly, that's what blew me away when I first started hearing how God was at work in Ukraine. But Michael was very, very clear about one thing, and I thought, let me just toss this in real quick. The number of people attending, those were estimates, okay? We had to kind of guess on some of that, but based on this, you know, count this many, I think this, I don't know if Billy does it this way, but you count this many, and then you count this many, and then see they're about the same, and that many, you can estimate that way. And I'm not sure how old they estimated, but they estimated the number of people who attended. But the people who responded, they count those four times after the concerts. And when God is really, really moving, Michael said he usually deducts 10%, just so we don't ever overstate what God is doing. It's because we don't want to, you know, you've heard the phrase, well, evangelistically speaking, you know, he takes a lot of safeguard to make sure that we don't overstate what's happening. But anyway, 1,000 seats, 2,000 attended, with 1,134 making decisions. Then we got to Kiev. We sang in the largest hall of the trip, the Ukrainia Palace of Culture, which seats 3,600 people. In that one concert, 3,300 people, is our estimated attendance, and 1,658 people responded to the gospel. If you remember, if I remember the figures correctly, we were told that this hall usually rents for around $40,000 American for like one concert. It is truly magnificent, and we would never have expected to sing here. It is always busy. But when Russia invaded Crimea and the eastern regions of Ukraine, groups who were booked in this hall began to cancel. They began to lose money. And when representatives from the Michael Gott Association contacted them, including, I'm told that Valeri, the music evangelist, that sang. He also had some connections, and I don't know with this hall, but in several of the places he was able to help, because the whole book, trip had to be rebooked. We could no longer go down the Dnieper River like the original plan was, because Crimea was closed by Russia. And so, and even that would be closer to the western, to the eastern portion of the country where the fighting had taken place. So we moved all the concerts west of the river. But anyway, when representatives from the Michael God Association contacted the management, they were able to negotiate a sweet deal. I think the amount the group had to pay was less than $10,000. God gave a great discount. And this is how God can use events around us to make a supernatural provision. We're so grateful for this. And our final concert was in Villa Cirque at the Rosava Palace of Culture. It seats 1,100 people, and we had 1,200 in attendance with 705 decisions. We didn't have pictures of that because the lady who was taking all the pictures was burning DVDs through the night to give it, to sell to us the next morning. Here are the figures then that you can see at all of those concerts when you add them together. 12 concerts total, attendance estimated to be 14,350, with a total response of 7,793 souls, and it was probably more than that. Amen?
Amen.
Is that good? But why am I telling you all this? Why am I going into such great detail? Well, first of all, that's just who I am. I'm sorry. But because God has called each one of us, each of His children, to use whatever He has given us to reach people with the gospel. Nearly 200 Texans did that very thing last month, and you can too. Some sang, some played instruments, one preached, one painted. Now those individuals were exercising specialized gifts and talents. But some went out on the streets near the concert venues to invite people to come in. Some handed out programs, some gave out Bibles, all prayed, all recruited prayer support back home, and all smiled and greeted the people with the love of Christ. Every one of us can do that. What has God placed within you that He can use to reach people for the kingdom of God? Can you swing a hammer and hit a nail? Can't drive a nail? Well then, can you prepare meals for those who can swing a hammer? Do you have specialized training in digging wells? Or can you teach Bible stories to children? Can you drive a bus? Are you an engineer? Do you have any medical training? Can you knock on doors? Ask God to show you what you can do to be involved in missions. We must reach people for Christ in Ukraine, in Belize, in Mexico, in Dallas, in Houston, and in Kingsville. This week, this past week, I contacted over 75 persons, asking them to pray for you who are here tonight. I asked them to pray for God to quicken our hearts for missions. I asked God to call out individuals who will seek opportunities to use their talents and gifts in taking the gospel outside the walls of our church, and for God to stir up our church to initiate mission work to enable us to fulfill our Acts 1:8 responsibility. About 25 years ago, God began to show me opportunities where I could use what He had placed within me to reach people, not only in my own church and my own town, but in Texas, New Mexico, Oklahoma, California, Missouri, Vermont, New Hampshire, Massachusetts, Maine, the Carolinas, Georgia, Tennessee, Florida, Washington, Canada, Hungary, Romania, Germany, Austria, Switzerland, England, Wales, Scotland, and now Ukraine. I am so very grateful for the incredible experiences that He has led me to, all of which He provided for. I am much richer in spirit because of where He has taken me and how God has used me. And I want that for each of you, don't you? What made Ukraine, Mission Ukraine, so successful? I got an email from Michael Gott in response to a question I asked, and this is what he told me. The high ratio of attendance versus response to the gospel was possible only because of three things. Number one, prayer. There were over 10,000 Americans praying for this trip, as well as Ukrainians. Number two, sometimes there were 75% of the audience who were lost, had never had an experience with Christ. How did they get there? Somebody probably invited them, you think? And number three, an unapologetic presentation of Christ with an evangelistic intensity in song and in spoken word. We were intentionally evangelistic. Jesus promised, if I be lifted up, I will draw people to myself, John 12. So we must pray, we must invite, and we must share.